yourself a round of applause for being here. It's an exciting time. I absolutely believe the Astros are going to come back and win the World Series. So, really, really exciting time for all of us. We've already had an amazing day. So, last night we had about 100 customers overnight. We had some great seminars today. We heard from Tommy Wall, one of the leading MSPs, many of our great vendor partners, and just a lot of great content, best practice sharing, and workshops that we've been able to put together over the last couple hours. I'm really excited about the future for all of us, for our channel, for the growth in the industry. We'll look at transformative technologies and solutions like 5G. I think our business is very vibrant and very, very exciting. For D&H, it couldn't be more exciting because of you. Thank you for all of your business. Thank you from all the folks at D&H that you allow to run your business every day. It is amazing being your partner, and we want to continue to get your feedback, get your ideas, and hear the things that we have to do better every day. Our business is growing. Our bar business is up 20% this year, on top of 20% last year. There's no end in sight in the growth when we look at S&D and K-12 and all the various markets we serve. And so we're really, really excited about our business moving forward, really based on all of you. The fact that we can earn your business every day, work with you, be open and honest, and hear the great things that you have to offer to us to make our business better every day. I am thrilled to introduce the next speaker, and then after that you'll have another amazing speaker as well, who's near and dear to my heart as I've watched the Buffalo Bills lose 4 Super Bowls against the Los Angeles Cowboys. But that's not the story right now. The story right now is about our next speaker, Jay Baer. Jay Baer came to us by way of a couple of vendor conferences that we did, as well as he spoke at our national sales meeting. And he is thrilling to be. He is amazing. He is energetic. He is odd at some times, but most of all, he has great ideas and great passion for what he does every day. You're not going to see anybody that's more engaging, more entertaining. And what he does is he helps businesses clone their customers. Think about that. He helps all of you, or can help all of you, clone your customers so you can get more customers and build your business with your existing customers. And he's already doing that today. He is a 7th generation entrepreneur, has written 6 best-selling books, and has founded 5 multi-million dollar companies. He's the president of Convince and Convert. Consulting firm that works with the world's most iconic brands like Oracle, Cisco, and 3M. He helps them gain new customers, and he helps them keep their existing customers in a really, really big way. He's a recent inductee into the Professional Speaking Hall of Fame. He's also an avid tequila collector. How about that, right? And a certified barbecue judge. I didn't know that there was a certification in judging barbecue. So Jay, good for that. Hang on to your seats, everybody. A warm welcome from Jay Baer.
This year for Peter, he's fantastic, ladies and gentlemen. He's a handsome and wise man, is what he is. Thank you. Yeah, I mean, if we had tequila and barbecue here, we could make that happen next time. I like this lighting. This is nice and dramatic, I feel like, up here, which is great because I am deceptively youthful looking. I have actually been in the technology business for a really long time. I got involved in digital marketing and online really, really early, about as early as you could have been. I started in that business in 1993. And that long ago, some of you remember those days. At that point, domain names were free. You could get whatever .com, .net, .org you wanted and pay nothing for it, because who would want to have a website What would you possibly do with a website was a legitimate question that I had to answer every single day. And ironically, we just had a session on cloud, so we've come pretty far in the last 26 years. But domain names were, of course, free at that point. And my partners and I, in my very first venture, circa 1993, we registered a bunch of domain names. And one of those domain names was Budweiser.com. We get a call one day from Anheuser-Busch Brewing, which then owned Budweiser.com, now, of course, owned by InBev. And they said, hey, we want to start our very first website, and it seems like you guys have the domain name. And we said, yes, we do. And they said, we'd like it back. And we said, we bet you would. But we're not just going to give it to you. You have to buy it from us. My partner and I sold Budweiser.com to Anheuser-Busch in 1993 for 50 cases of beer. That is 100% a true story, and we genuinely thought that we got such a good deal. Because I was, thank you, I was, it's the first time people have ever applauded at that story. I'm not really sure to make of any of you. I was 23 at the time, and 50 cases of beer is a whole shit ton of beer, right? Like, it's a lot. It really is a lot. And then later, I went on vacation. I was so happy. I'm triumphantly. And while I was gone, my partner registered some other domain names without me. Didn't put my name on the paperwork. Didn't even think about it. Domain names are free. Who would even think about it? One of those domain names, beer.com, you can see a theme developing in our registrations. He subsequently sold to Molson Brewing for $5.1 million. And he has never worked a day since. And I'm here in Houston with you. So there you go. Thanks, you guys. I appreciate it. End of presentation. One of the things I've learned across now almost 30 years doing marketing and sales and customer service and customer experience is we have a really interesting interplay between, as Peter mentioned in the introduction, how we get customers and how we keep customers. How we get customers and how we keep customers. How many of you have ever spent any sort of time, money, effort, thinking on some sort of advertising? Anybody? Yeah, pretty much everybody here. I want you to take a look at this, because this is how a lot of advertising feels to our customers today.
Howdy, y'all. This here's Mike. Down at Mike's Golf Shop, where we buy golf. That's right. We buy golf clubs. Mike's Golf Shop. Come on over here. We buy golf clubs. Over at Mike's Golf Shop. Come on down here. We buy golf clubs. That's right. We buy golf clubs. We buy golf clubs. We buy golf clubs. We buy golf clubs. We buy golf clubs.
That is an A+ for message consistency. There's no, like, there's no ambiguity there whatsoever. Anybody here from Tennessee? Because that's your guy. Congratulations. Running for governor, probably. That's the guy. Here's the problem. That may have worked at one point, to some degree, but it doesn't work now. Because one of the things that's happened, and one of the things that the internet has made possible, is that fundamentally today, everybody sells approximately the same things. Do they not? D&H sells the exact same things as their competitors. You sell fundamentally the same things as your competitors. And consequently, by next year, which is like 2 months away, customer experience will be the most important factor in how customers make business-to-business buying decisions, superseding even price. When everybody has the same thing, and everybody sells that thing for approximately the same price, what is your only differentiator? It is customer experience. And we talk about customer experience all the time, don't we? you're probably sick of hearing about it. And I think we totally overcomplicate it. It's quite simple. Customer experience is simply how we make our customers feel, how we make them feel every time they interact with our businesses. But those feelings don't exist in a vacuum. Those feelings are always governed by what I call the expectation equation. The expectation equation works like this. Every customer you have today, every customer you will ever have, has a set of expectations about how every interaction with your business will go. You do the exact same thing. You have an expectation for how this presentation will go. You have an expectation for what's going to happen at the exhibit hall in just a minute. You have an expectation for the World Series. Peter's expectation is wildly optimistic, but we all have these expectations. We carry them around like in an invisible fanny pack. And when you can exceed those expectations in one or more ways, that's where a great customer experience lives. And when you fall short of them, that's where you get a bad customer experience. It's all based on what they expect. So the question then becomes, how do we exceed expectations? Well, I'm here to tell you that the easiest way to exceed customer expectations is actually with customer service. Now you might think, well, Jay, that doesn't make any sense. Customer service isn't easy. Customer service is actually really hard. It is hard. But remember, customer experience is about expectations, not about whether it's easy or hard in a vacuum. Here's the key stat. 80% of businesses say that they deliver superior service. Not satisfactory, not pretty good. 8 out of 10 businesses say, when asked, they deliver superior service to their customers. 8% of their customers agree. Massive gap in expectations. Your customers, generally speaking, expect very little in the area of customer service. So you can exceed those expectations almost every time. How? By following what I call the hug your haters model. Now, there's lots of things you can do in terms of proactive customer service, predictive customer service, answering customer questions before they need to be asked. We'll touch on that a little bit today. But what we're going to focus on the most is how you handle customers who are dissatisfied with whatever you provide for some reason. They don't like their salesperson, they don't like the price, something is late, they're confused about shifting to cloud from on-prem. There's something going on that they do not love. How many of you, raise your hand, have 100% satisfied customers? Nobody. It's impossible. There is no business ever that has 100% satisfied customers. Some of you are, of course, familiar with the Net Promoter Score methodology. Jason mentioned it in the last session. Net Promoter Score measures the propensity of people to tell nice things about you. The very best companies in the world at Net Promoter Score are in the high 80s, meaning that 12 people out of 100 are like, nah, not really for me. And those are the best companies in the entire world. So how do we do this? How do we use customers who are unhappy in some way as a way to exceed their expectations and build our businesses? The first piece of this hug your haters model is that we have to embrace complaints. Fundamentally embrace complaints. As Peter mentioned, I've started many companies and I'm an advisor to 30 or 40 or 50 other companies. And one of the things that I have discovered over time is that almost invariably we tolerate complaints, good businesses do at least, but we don't embrace them. And one of the things I talk about in the book, which is the sort of book version of this presentation, it's called Hug Your Haters. One of the things I talk about in the book is that praise is massively overrated. I think that praise is the most overrated thing in business and maybe the most overrated thing in life. Because every time somebody says to you, oh, you're so great at this. Oh, you're so terrific at that. You're really good at this thing. Man, it makes you feel terrific, doesn't it? But it doesn't teach us anything. Because in almost every case, we already know what we're good at, don't we? So to have that reinforced, to have that ratified, to have that repeated is psychologically terrific. But it doesn't make us any better. What makes us a better business, what makes us a better husband or wife or parent or friend or volunteer, what makes us better is, in fact, negative feedback and criticism. It is the raw materials for improvement. So we have to understand in our businesses that when people are unhappy, that can actually be a good thing if we embrace complaints. My friend Aaron Pepper was until fairly recently the head of customer service and marketing for a business called Le Pain Quotidien. Le Pain Quotidien is a chain of bakeries and cafes. They're based in Brussels, Belgium. There's 400 or so locations. There's many here in the US as well, mostly major cities. There's some in New York and Chicago. There's some in Los Angeles. I don't know if there are any in Houston. I should have looked, but I forgot to. They run a good business. As bakeries and cafes go, they run a good business. They run a tight ship. They really do. But when Aaron was hired, probably 5 years ago now, she called a meeting. Executive team. CEO is there, COO is there, chief marketing officer is there, CTO is there. Welcome, Aaron. Delighted to have you on board. She said, I'm delighted to be here. Thank you so much. But before I sort of jump into this job feet first, I'd like you to tell you my plan. I said, oh, by all means, we're all here in the boardroom. Please tell us your plan, Aaron. She said, my plan is that we will get triple the number of complaints that we get today. And the CEO said, who hired Aaron? Because this seems like a real bad plan. She said, no, hear me out. We're a good business, right? We run a disproportionately good, we are an operationally sound organization. Yeah, yeah, we're high five. Yes, Aaron, yes. She said, but we're not perfect. No business is. And the only way we're going to be able to improve, the only way we're going to be able to retain even more customers, to reduce churn even further, is to fix things that maybe we don't even know are a problem. So what she did is she went through all the different touch points that they have with their customers. And in each of those points, built in a nudge for feedback. Receipts, signage in the restrooms, emails, social media, website, trained the cashiers to do it verbally. In each of these touch points, there was a message that said, approximately, here at Le Pain Quotidien, we want to be the best chain of bakeries and cafes in the world, but we can only get there if we know exactly how your experience was. So please take a moment and let us know how your experience was. And you can tell us in any way you want. You want to call us, great. You want to email us, that's fantastic. You want to send us a text message, that's great. You want a smoke signal, hostage note, like whatever you want to do, we're listening. And guess what happened? She got 3 times more complaints. Complaint volume literally tripled. But inside those complaints were a bunch of things that customers like, you know, I don't love this, that they didn't even know were an issue. And they fixed those things. And guess what happened next? All the complaints went away. What Aaron understands, and I think we all should understand, is that to get fewer complaints, you first must get more complaints. It is a two-step process. And there's a difference between tolerating a complaint and encouraging in every way, shape, and form customers to let you know exactly how their experience was, yes? And I understand, I am a business owner and have been for a long time. As Peter mentioned, I'm a seventh generation entrepreneur. I come from business owners since the Vikings times, not the Minnesota Vikings, the Danish Vikings. I know what it feels like to own a business and have an unhappy customer. It feels like somebody is telling you that your baby is ugly, right? And nobody wants to hear that, even when they know that their baby is ugly. And any of you who are on Facebook will back me up on that. Every baby picture posted has 16,000 likes, and sometimes that baby, like, that's a monster. That baby is hideous. But you hit that like button anyway. Understand this, that even though negativity and complaints is difficult, nobody wants it, hurts your heart, it's actually mathematically pretty rare. In fact, out of every 100 dissatisfied customers, okay, 100 unhappy customers, out of that group, only 5 will complain. Five. The other 95 just disappear. They're mad, but they don't tell you. They just quit buying from you. So the 5 that go on record, the 5 that say, you know what? I would prefer that this happened. Those 5 are actually doing us an enormous favor. Because quite literally, they are taking their time to tell us what we can do better. And sometimes we think in business, I'm certainly guilty of this, well, that's crazy. Nobody's ever had that problem before. Mathematically speaking, 19 other people have had that problem. They just didn't say anything about it. I've done tons and tons of work in this topic. We work with lots and lots of businesses all over the world on customer service. And I've discovered, somewhat to my horror, very rarely are there truly one-off problems, where this customer had this weird thing that only happened to them. They're the only one who ever had that problem. You know, this never happens. The soup is never cold. Dude, the soup is almost always cold, as it turns out. So what I'm here to tell you may be controversial, but I really believe this to be true. And hopefully you understand where I'm coming from. Your unhappy customers are truly your most important customers. They can take you further as an organization than your happiest customers. And this has been proven scientifically over and over and over and over through decades and decades and decades of research. Some of you are probably familiar with this premise that when you have an unhappy customer and you can fix their problem, they actually buy more and are more loyal than customers who never had a problem at all. Think about that. They had a problem, you fixed it. They actually give you more money and are less likely to use a competitor than somebody who has been smooth sailing the whole time. That is truly one of the most significant research findings in business. I was doing a presentation in Canada earlier this year for a big appliances company, very similar market dynamics to what you all do. I can't tell you the name of the company, but it rhymes with girl school. And they told me after the presentation that they have a department, a division in their organization that is the most profitable division, inside sales team, most profitable in the company. And they said, Jay, it's because of this. I said, what do you mean? Well, it turns out when somebody calls this appliances manufacturer and has a problem with their washer, dryer, their dishwasher, their refrigerator, what have you, they flag it in a database, and then they try to solve it. Send out a part, send a repair person, field repair, whatever the circumstances are. If they can successfully fix it, they double flag it in the database. And then 3 to 4 weeks later, this inside sales team calls that customer and tries to cross-sell them. Hey, how's it working out with your dishwasher? Did we get that fixed? Great. Hey, have you ever thought about getting a new washer dryer? We have this awesome new model. the single most successful and profitable sales organization in the entire enterprise company because of this psychology. If you can solve their problem, they literally will give you more money. So what I'm telling you is that haters, the people who complain, the people who don't like you, that is not your problem. That's a myth. Ignoring them is your problem. And in many cases, that is our default stance. If somebody doesn't like us, I don't want to go there. There's other fish in the sea. Embrace complaints. When we embrace complaints, it has to be every complaint, not just the ones that are easy to answer, not just the ones that aren't mean to us. It's every complaint. The research that I did for the book found that 33%, fully one-third of all customer complaints are never answered. Raise your hand if that's ever happened to you. You complained to a business and heard nothing back. Almost everybody here. Keep your hand up if that made you feel better. Right? Of course it doesn't. Because no response is a response, isn't it? No response is a response that says we care so little about your satisfaction that we refuse to even acknowledge it. You mean nothing to us. A customer you ignore is a customer you will lose. You will lose that customer. It's just when. That's the only question that remains. We decided to put some math around this point, and we did the research for the book, and we found that when you ignore a customer, some sort of a complaint, their customer advocacy, as measured by Net Promoter Score, drops by 50%. Doesn't matter what they complained about, doesn't matter what the circumstances are, if they don't hear back from you, their advocacy drops by half. That's massive. But here's the good news. If a customer complains and you do respond, even if, this is important, even if you can't fix the problem, even if you can't fix it, you just respond, it increases their advocacy by 25%. Because you're demonstrating that you care. The customer is not always right. Anybody who stands on a stage like this with a microphone like this and a clicker in their other hand and says the customer is always right is either lying to you or has never run a business. By no means is the customer always right. But the customer should always be heard. It is mathematically and scientifically proven to build your business if you take the time to answer every complaint. Every complaint, every time, and the third piece of the model, everywhere. One of the great changes in customer service over the last decade and a half, is that today, like never before, customer service is more often a spectator sport. Many of us are old enough to remember the days when if somebody had a problem with you, they could complain face-to-face or on the telephone, or send you an angry fax. Like, that was the list, right? Now, of course, customers provide feedback in all these other places. Obviously, email, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, G2, all these other different websites, local websites, everywhere. And this scenario of customer feedback becoming public for everybody to see is just going to get more and more and more and more and more and more impactful. I have two kids shown here. This picture is a couple years old, but my daughter's 21. She's a junior in college. My son just started his freshman year in college a month ago, and they have smartphones. You know, obviously, I'm a tech guy at some level. For people this age, there is no product in the history of products that is more inappropriately named than smartphone. Because of all the functions of this device, and it does a lot of things, like you could launch a rocket from this thing, the one thing that they don't want to do at all is talk on the phone. My son will not talk on the phone at bayonet point. He wants literally nothing to do with it. on a very, very rare occasion, he will actually place a phone call, almost always when I make him do it. Recently, it was my mother's birthday, and I said, Ethan, call Grammy for her birthday. I'm like, you got, call Grammy. She wants to hear your actual voice. So I essentially throw him the phone, and here's the entire conversation on his end. Hello? Fine. 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 Okay. And hands the phone back. I'm like, oh, that's like a Lifetime movie. That was so beautiful. A grandson and his grandmother chatting it up on the phone. It was just brutal, right? And this is how it works. Some new research came out. 81% of millennials, and my son's Gen Z, he's younger than that. 81% of millennials say that they need to summon courage to make a phone call. Like your evil Knievel jumping over the Snake River Canyon. Like, man, I gotta dial these seven digits. I'm gonna need a shot of whiskey first. My daughter had to go to, before she went to college, she had to get a physical, get a checkup, you know? Because she had to go on the university insurance. And she's like, I gotta make this appointment for the physician. And I'm like, yeah. She's like, well, how do I do that? And I thought she was like trying to trick me or something. I said, well, what do you mean? So I gotta make an appointment. How do I do that? And I well, you call the doctor's office and make an appointment. I still didn't quite understand where she's coming from. She's like, yeah, I know, but how? And I was like, wait, like, you know how a phone works, right? We all have seven digits and that goes to a specific phone in the world. She's like, yeah, I understand all that, but I don't know what to say. She's on scholarship, okay? This isn't just like, it's not like she's a dumb kid. She's just that age. And I said, oh, well, you just say, hi, I'm Monica Baer and I need to make an appointment. She's like, that's all there is to it? Like, did you think there's like a series of physical challenges that, like, yeah, that's all you gotta do. But here's the thing. Today, depending on your customer mix, people probably still use the phone a lot. That's not going to last. If you have a group in your organization that's either officially or colloquially known as the call center, you're gonna need to print new business cards because nobody's gonna call anymore. Right? There just won't. Nobody wants that synchronous conversation. They want to send messages. And so that means that we've got to address customers in all of those places. And a lot of those happen in reviews. Best sign of all time. Again, nailed it. Worst rum and coke that one guy on Yelp ever had in his life. Reviews, so important. And we think, oh, you know, it's not that important in our business. It is. If there's not a review site that matters in your market now, there will be soon enough. And 80% of Americans, 80% of Americans trust reviews as much as they trust recommendations from friends and family. And I don't know if that says more about the importance of reviews or less about the nature of American friends and family, but either way, it's really important. It drives colossal amounts of business. Sometime I'll come back and do another presentation for you guys just about ratings and reviews. But for now, I want to tell you the fourth piece of the Hug Your Haters model, which is when we respond, we have to do so expediently. And this has gotten more important even since I wrote the book. Expectations that customers have around speed, straight up. New research recently from Walker said, business-to-business customers, that's us, with high expectations for speed, 4% in 2013, 77% next year. So if you don't answer them fast enough, you don't even get credit for answering at all. And look, it's hard. Sometimes we fail at being fast enough. Amanda goes on Twitter. This is an actual tweet. Guys, I'm trapped in an Amtrak elevator at Baltimore's BWI Airport. Help! This is a distress tweet, right? We're all clear on that? Everybody's good with that? 205 days later, That's not fast enough. Apparently, she was able to MacGyver herself out of the elevator and crawled to safety and never rode a train again. Remember, this entire premise is about exceeding expectations, right? The expectation equation. And speed expectations are going up, so we have to be faster than ever. Paul and Tim run an accounting firm, Bogdanoff and Dodges, in Indianapolis. They are a business-to-business accounting firm, primarily small business tax accounting. They have the two of them as principals. They have one or two associates, a front desk person or two, so it's a small firm. There are thousands and thousands of accounting firms just like that in America, all over the country, right? Except they made a decision, a choice, to exceed customer expectations with speed. With speed. They reply to every customer phone message and every customer email within 5 minutes. At all times. If Paul's on the phone, Tim handles it. If they're both on the phone, the associate handles it. If everybody's on the phone, the front desk clerk person responds and says they're on the phone, they'll get back to you. Now, I have had, I think, 11 accountants in my business career. All of them good, as far as I know. But I've never said, hey, Peter, I checked my return and all the numbers added up. That's what we expect accountants to do. But if your accountant routinely responded to your email and your call within 5 minutes every time, is that a story you tell? Would that exceed your expectations? Absolutely. And it's even more important when somebody has a problem. When somebody has a problem. Even if you can't solve the problem, getting back to them quickly makes it a lot better. And just a quick note on that. So what I see a lot in the consulting side of our business is people say, okay, well, sometimes, Jay, a customer will call us or email us, and they have kind of a complicated issue. It's going to take some research to look into it. Like, well, what happened here exactly? And, you know, the thing didn't get shipped on time, or we're missing something, there's some damage. You got to do some CSI work, right? You guys with me? It's not just, you don't know off the top of your head. So what we do is we wait until we figured it out, and then we let them know, here's what happened. And I understand why people do that, because they don't want to, you know, they want to find out the answer. That's not the right way to do it, okay? We've researched this a million times over. Trust me when I tell you this. If somebody has an issue, you get back to them immediately in the channel they chose. If they call, you call. If they email, you email. Okay? Whatever channel they picked, they did that for a reason. They didn't play contact mechanism roulette and land on phone accidentally. That's the one they prefer. So you don't channel shift them. And you respond to them as quickly as you possibly can and say, we got your message. We're going to do some research and get back to you with an answer. Do not wait until you figure it out. Because that whole time that you're figuring it out, they're like, did they get it? What's going on? Are they blowing me off? Their angst level goes up, 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 up the whole time that you're figuring it out. Just let them know that you're on it and you'll get back to them. Way better plan. Okay? Last thing is to interact with unhappy customers with empathy. Now, lots of times in business, things happen that you know, it just didn't work out, you know? Act of God. We made a mistake. Something happened. You are not fully in control of everything that could possibly happen every single day to every customer, right? Especially in your business, right? You're working with D&H and other suppliers, and you know there's a lot of moving parts in what you do. And some things just happen. So you can't control everything, but you have complete and total control over what happens next. Over what happens next. Empathy is the most important thing when you're interacting with customers. The most important thing. My friend Chris is a graphic designer. He lives in Bloomington, Indiana, where I live now. And Chris, for reasons that I don't fully understand, has in his home all white carpet, snow white, whole house, which is a terrible idea. Even if you're a rapper, it's a bad idea. It doesn't matter. Bad call. Especially if you have a cat. Okay? Who has a cat here? I'm just curious. Raise your hand if you have a cat. Wow. Let's do that again. Raise your hand if you have a cat. Holy cow. Okay. D&H customers hate cats. The partners do not like cats. That's weird. It's 29% of American households have cats, or 2.9 of this room. Interesting. It's a good point, Texas. Probably, it's a good point. You're not wrong. Probably dog country, right? Yeah. Who was a horse? Let's just check on that. Who was an armadillo? All right. You all know what a cat is, though, right? Everybody's familiar with the breed, the whole idea? So I can continue with the story. All right. I have a cat and a dog. Although that's not really the right way you say it. You don't really say, like, I have a cat, because you don't own cats the same way you own dogs, because cats don't care about us at all. At all. It's a straight-up roommate situation. Right? Found you on Craigslist. That's all they care about, right? And my cat, and Chris's cat, and the four of you who have cats, remarkably, have all experienced this. Cats, well, just like, well, number one, they don't really walk, right? They strut, right? They've got attitude, or catitude, as they call it. And they do that, and they're strutting around, and then, for no reason, just out of the clear blue sky, all of a sudden, the cat says, whoa. And they just vomit all over the house. And then, like nothing even happened, they walk the other way like, you should do something about that. This is a problem if you have all white carpet. Chris, my friend, decides to send an email to the Meow Mix brand cat food company, which makes his cat food, asking them to make their food only in neutral colors. That's the right reaction, sir. That is a ridiculous email to send. Guess what he heard back? Nothing. He heard nothing back. But Chris is that guy. We all have a friend like this. Chris is like, I'm taking it public, man. So he goes on their Facebook page, where they have 450,000 fans. And he leaves this note. This is an actual word-for-word note.
Dear Meow Mix, cats throw up pretty regularly. I figured you guys would realize this, being cat experts and all. With this in mind, why do you insist on putting dyes in your products that cause ruined carpets, furniture, etc.? You know, when Kitty spews her half-digested meow yuck all over the place. Seriously, my cat doesn't give a shit what your product looks like in a bowl, and neither do I. What would be helpful and appreciated by legions of cat owners, I'm guessing, is if you take the worthless dyes out of your product and save us all a lot of frustration and ruined fabrics.
Chris is upset, obviously. On Facebook, the Meow Mix Corporation decided to answer him. They responded, again, this is in public, in front of as many as 450,000 people. Here's what they said, word for word.
Hi, Chris. All Meow Mix products are made with nutritious quality ingredients that meet the standards and specifications of the U.S. Department of Agriculture, USDA, Association of American Feed Control Officials, AAFCO, and the Food and Drug Administration, FDA. If you have further questions, our consumer affairs team will be able to help you. You can reach them at 1-877-MEOWMIX, 877-636-9649, or by visiting meowmix.com and clicking the Contact Us link at the bottom of the page.
Raise your hand if you now feel better about the Meow Mix Corporation. Nobody. They made a classic mistake. Everything they said was true. 100% factually true. But they made a classic mistake. They tried to information the customer to death. We do the same thing. This business has so many facts and figures and details and bullet points and other stuff that nobody cares about but you. And in almost every case, when you have an unhappy customer, the first thing is empathy, and the second thing is information. Because most of the time, they don't care about the information at all. They just want you to say, oh man, I'm sorry. We'll do better next time. Don't get sucked into the information. It's too easy to do that.
I just bought this.
there is plenty of oxygen on the high road. And when we consistently take that road, when we use empathy, it exceeds customer expectations. Again, that's the whole point of the Hug Your Haters model, is to exceed expectations. And customers don't expect empathy anymore. That's how we used to do business all the time. We used to treat customers with dignity and warmth and respect and kindness all the time, but we don't anymore. So now when you do, they're like, wow, that was amazing. Friends, customer service is the best way to exceed expectations and create great experiences because they expect so little of you. The world has trained customers to expect terrible customer service. It's true. So if you can do something else, if you can embrace complaints, if you can answer all the complaints and do that everywhere and do it quickly and do it with empathy, you will be well on your way to using customer service to your greatest possible advantage. Friends, your unhappy customers are your most important customers. Embrace complaints, every complaint, everywhere, expediently, with empathy. That, my friends, is the Hug Your Haters model. Thanks so much for being here. I really appreciate it. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Good. So I am I'm super pumped to be here and bring up our very special guest. He is from Pensacola, Florida. Famously matriculated at the University of Florida, had an incredible three seasons there. Ended up being drafted by your, not mine, probably your, Dallas Cowboys. Won three Super Bowl championships, was the Super Bowl most valuable player, was the most valuable player of the National Football League, is in the 100-year history of the NFL,
the all-time leading rusher and the all-time leading rushing touchdown scorer, a no-brainer NFL Hall of Famer. He is now a very, very successful businessman in real estate and in retail. He's also spent a lot of time in sports broadcasting. Please welcome, as part of the DHTC19, Mr. Evan Smith!
What's up? How's everybody?
Thanks for being here.
Oh, yeah.
Let's hear it for Emmett. Thanks for coming.
I missed the personality to my right.
So I got to tell you, I heard a story earlier today about your first game in high school. One of the things that's interesting about this group, Mr. Smith, is that they all run their own businesses, but they're also part of the D&H team. And I heard that you learned an important lesson about team in that very first game. You want to tell these guys that story?
Well, first of all, let me just say it's an honor to be here, and hopefully you guys are having a great, great conference. I mean, I don't know which story you heard or
or whether or not
it's actually true. But my first season, and I think this is the story that you may be going with. My first season in high school football, I was a freshman, true freshman, and my high school coach, Dwight Thomas, never allowed a freshman to play on the varsity squad. And so this was his first time, and a lot of players were actually trying to convince him into allowing myself and one other guy to move up and play on the varsity squad. And so he finally committed to doing it, and right before the season got started, he decided to place me in as the starter. And so I started my freshman football season.
You're like, what, 14 or something like that?
Yes, I was 14.
Wow.
I was 14 playing on varsity. And I was having pretty decent season. And he never really allowed any of the freshmen to talk to any of the press. That was one of his pet peeves. And so this went on for about 5 weeks. And then finally, one night, I didn't do nothing spectacular. I just rushed for 245 yards on eight carries, and I scored two touchdowns. And so finally, he broke down to the press. And so they wanted to ask these questions. And so I'd never had media training. never was prepped about it, and so forth. And so he said, these guys are going to ask you some questions, so you just have to answer these questions. Give them the best answers that you possibly can. I'm like, okay, no problem. And so they proceeded to ask these questions, and I gave them these answers. They're like, Emmett, how did you do this? You rushed for 245 yards. You scored 2 touchdowns and all those kind of things. And I just started talking about what I did. I got the handoff. I described the play. I made the guy miss and off to the races I was running. They gave it to me on the left side. The same thing happened. I made the guy miss off to the races I was running. And before you know it, I was 245 yards later and 2 touchdowns. And so afterwards, my coach come up to me, put his arms around me as we walked back into the locker room. He said, listen, every chance you get, you share the spotlight with those 5 guys up front because you didn't block for yourself and you didn't throw the ball to yourself and you definitely didn't snap the ball to yourself. So I'm like, okay, coach, I got it. No problem. So we fast forward. We roll up around the Monday, practice, getting ready to start. So we come up to the pose like we normally do, all 50-something or 75 players, stand right there. Coach walks in the middle, and he blows the whistle. He said, I want first string, I want 9 on 7, 9 defensive players versus 7 offensive players. For all of y'all who cannot do the math, that's 2 more men than we can block. And so I'm lining up back there, tightening up my chin strap, because I know it's about to be on and popping. And they say, Hutt, they hand me the football. I run up to the line of scrimmage. My whole offensive line lays down on the ground. I get hit by every defensive player. I get up saying, coach, I got it. I got it. I understand. It was a lesson in humility because nobody becomes successful by themselves. That's truly the message. And everybody on that football field, like every one of you in this room, in your businesses, we also have people that are working for us and working with us and helping us move the ball forward. In business, it's the same thing. No man or no woman becomes successful by themselves. You got to have the right support staff, no matter what it is that we're doing. This hotel cannot operate and function the way it functions without the people doing what they need to do. So everybody deserves credit in the success of anybody. And if they don't give it to them, they're pretty selfish. And they I've seen people be successful being selfish, but it's not the right environment, I should say.
Yeah, that's fantastic. What a great story. Thank you so much. Let's hear from Emmett. Is that great? The part about that story, you just sort of like threw it out. There's 245 yards on 8 carries, right? It's amazing. You want to tell us all the people you know who are selfish in business? That'd be great. Let's just do that. Yeah, just give us a list. You can just start right now. Just tell us.
Some people don't make mistakes.
Exactly.
They blame others for those mistakes.
So I love this theme about teamwork and working and succeeding. Everything you end up doing, it's amazing. You end up being the best at.
I try to be the best at it.
I work hard to be the best at it. Obviously football, but you also won. Didn't just compete. You won Dancing with the Stars.
Yeah.
And that's no joke, man. Like that. Tell us a little bit about that. That ain't easy.
No, man.
That's a lot of work. And you didn't have a background in it, I don't think.
No dance background whatsoever. But, you know, I could dance. I could just couldn't ballroom dance.
Different deal.
Yeah. But here's the thing. Just like I talked about teamwork, when my partner Cheryl and I got together, we both established the simple fact that, number one, I established in my mind, I did not know what the heck I was doing. Number two, I knew that she was a previous champion, and so there was no reason for me to bring my ego into the room. I needed to humble myself to allow this 22-year-old girl, young lady, I should say, teach me the ballroom styles and the things that I needed to learn. My naivety came in the fact that, hey, here I am, I'm like, hey, how hard can it be to learn a minute and 20-second routine? So we started out practicing 4 hours a day, and I had a whole month to prepare for 2 dances. But once the season began, you only have 7 days, and so everything speeds up. And so when I got beat by Jerry Springer,
that's when it was on.
It changed everything. My perspective on dancing all changed. My perspective on how much time it required for me to get prepared, all of that stuff changed. And so as a competitor, when you get beat by Jerry Springer, all bets are off. So I went from 4 hours to 8 hours, and from 8 hours to 12 hours to try and get myself to the position to where I did not get voted off. And so it lasted all the way to the end. And at the end of the day, I learned that while I was having fun, not to take yourself so seriously. Enjoy the moment and enjoy the process. Some of the fundamentals that we all have learned throughout our training, it's always there and it applies in multiple areas of our lives. Sometimes people like to think that it just stays here. It's one thing to leave work there, but it's another thing to bring work ethic with you no matter where you go. And that's what I was able to do through Dance with the Stars, is to continue that work ethic, continue that competitive spirit and that focus that's required in order to do it. But I learned how to relax and enjoy myself and enjoy the ride at the same time.
Isn't that amazing? It's great. It's here for Emmett. Do you still do it? Do you still do that?
No.
No, that was it?
That was
you
it.
You won the title and dropped the mic and
won
no more
title,
dancing.
Won the title, dropped the mic, and I kept on pushing.
Once beaten by Jerry Springer is not part of your official biography. I've discovered that. No.
Jerry Springer was a great, great competitor, great person. I enjoyed being around him, and he helped bring out some of the best in you.
That's great. Who plays fantasy football here? Just curious. Fantasy football players? Yeah, you got a handful here. I want to. So in 1995, here's Emmett's season: 1,773 rushing yards. 25 rushing touchdowns, 62 catches, 300 yards receiving, 300, 400 yards receiving, something like that. That's a league winner in today's fantasy football. And you never almost ever see that kind of season anymore. And I want to ask you a football question here. What you did, really your whole career, that season in particular, and just feeding you the ball, feeding you the ball, feeding you the ball. That never happens in football anymore. This idea that, hey, we're going to keep running backs fresh and they're kind of interchangeable and we're going to have two, three guys and a lot of contract disputes now about running backs and the position has changed a ton. Do you think that's just a cycle in the game or fundamental, just different, football is different now?
I think football is different. It's different in the context. Think about what you just talked about. Your kids can't even make an appointment.
Yeah, and on college scholarship.
And on college scholarship.
Yeah, makes you wonder.
So it is different. The kids that are growing up today, some of them are growing up already being told that they're special, they're this. We all have gone through that. But the one thing that's missing is truly the mental toughness to overcome certain things. Sometimes when you get a hangnail, they go sit down. Sometimes they show up with a headache, they go sit down. Back in our day, we was forced to go through certain things in order to get on the other side of it. So you learned the levels of what you can physically do from a human being standpoint. Nowadays, they hit that threshold, they back off. They don't push a little bit further. Not every child is able to do that. And not every child should do that. But then, there are great coaches that help bring out the best in you, like a Jerry Springer helped bring out the best in me. There are great folks that help pull some of the greatness out of you. And you have to have those kind of mentors and people around you in order to know what you truly are capable of doing. And until you trust, because I think trust is broken now. Yeah. Kids these days, I was talking to Adam, his son is 12. There's a 6'5 guy that's probably the same age as his kid. His kid by this guy, and the guy's up here throwing 84 miles an hour. Sports have become more specialized now. We don't allow our kids to play football, basketball, run track, baseball, maybe even swimming nowadays. No, we say, no, you're going to do this, and you're going to concentrate on that. So sometimes when you ask a kid, or a basketball player, a professional basketball player, you ask him to throw a baseball out, he looks very awkward because he never had the opportunity to play both sports. He has focused on one thing and one thing only. And so therefore he's limited in his thought process because that's all that he knows. As a football player, whether or not I play offense, defense, growing up, and if I ran track, great. If I played baseball, awesome. I had the ability to have coaching from different perspectives and to be able to time all into making me the best football player that I can possibly become. I don't see that with kids these days. And you're right, head trauma has also played a major part in making the adjustments because every person cannot carry the ball as much as we used to back in our day. I heard Stephen Jones say this. He said, they don't make them like you no more. I'm like, I'm not sure how they made me, but I'm pretty thankful. But the reality of it is there are a handful of guys that can do it. But you have to give them a chance to do it. You just cannot just say, we're going to stop it. Because Ezekiel Elliott is a guy that could probably carry the load that many times and continue to stay healthy. And that's the key, is staying healthy. Can you shoulder the load and stay healthy and be productive, even if you're not as, even if you're not 100%? Is your 90% better than most people 100%? And in some cases, that was the case with me as well.
Zeke, your favorite player in the NFL right now?
Right now, I mean, as far as running backs goes, I think Zeke Elliott, Kamara down in New Orleans is very special. Saquon Barkley is very, very special. There are a number of guys out here that has the potential to be pretty good.
But pretty good and then great for 15 years is not the same thing.
Well, that's, you got to get to 15 years to determine what great looks like.
Yeah, that's right.
And that's the endurance test.
That's it.
That's truly what it is. It's the endurance test and the longevity test. Eye candy-wise, they look great.
Yeah.
They look great.
Speaking of longevity and endurance, I'm originally from Arizona, and so I in Phoenix, I had Cardinal season tickets for a long, long, long time. I was right there your last two seasons, saw you play a bunch of times. I think you played, 10 and then 25 games with the Cardinals, and I saw all the home games that you played there. That must have been such a huge change in your life, to spend 13 years in Dallas, and then we're going to Phoenix. That must have been really disruptive. And this industry, the technology industry, also constantly, famously, goes through disruptions about every 20 minutes. What advice do you have for these folks about navigating change?
Well, football is all about change, to be honest with you. It's just like technology. I mean, there's the ebb and flow of every game. There's the ebb and flow of every position. There's a time when you're winning. There's a time when somebody's getting beat throughout the course of the game, every play. So change is something that we had to adapt to. I mean, as a running back, that's one of the key elements that I was able to do, is make an adjustment and process it faster than the next person. So change is something that I had to deal with my whole entire life, whether or not I started out playing in a quarterback position and thinking that that's what I wanted to do, be like Roger Staubach, and then when I'm 9, they changed me over to a running back, because that's what I did with the ball when I played quarterback. All I did was run. So it made perfect sense. It made perfect sense, but it was something that I had to make an adjustment to. And so making that adjustment, it all boiled down to, do I love the game? And am I in the right position for what I do? And being put in the right position for what I do and understanding what my skill set was and honing that skill set and making it better is what I had to do. I had to work on those things. And so changes is something that hits everybody. Just like technology evolves every 30 seconds, we all are evolving every 30 seconds. I mean, I'm not as good as I was last year was, but I'm twice as good as I used to be mentally. I may not be as physically fit as I used to be, but mentally.
Yeah, you're looking pretty bad, Emmett. Yeah, well, yeah, looking pretty rough up here.
Yeah, you know, I do the best I can what I have to work with. That's all. But, you know, all I can say is change, it creates opportunity. That's really what it does. It creates opportunities for us to learn things that we didn't know before. It creates opportunities for us to explore areas that we never explored before. And to adapt and to adjust where we are for the better, not necessarily for the worse. Nobody wants to change for the worse. We all want to change for the better. If you're striving to be the best, that's the way you have to look at change. What's on the other side of this thing that's going to make me better than what I am today?
Boy, isn't that something? Let's hear it for the remarkable Mr. Emmett Smith, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Oh, man, that's so great. So great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Friends, we're going to go to the Expo Hall. You can meet Emmett in the Dell booth. We've got signed memorabilia from Mr. Smith available at Intel and at Microsoft. On behalf of all my friends at D&H, thanks so much for being here. And one more round of applause, please, for Mr. Emmett Smith. Thank you, Emmett.